Hey everyone, welcome back to Tun Does Linux. It's been another eventful week in the Linux world, and today we're covering everything from kernel updates to some pretty interesting takes from Linus Torvalds himself on AI and coding. Before we dive in, if you're new here, this channel is all about keeping you updated on the latest in Linux, open source, and everything in between. So, if that sounds good to you, consider subscribing and hitting that notification bell. All right, let's get into it. So let's start with the kernel. Linux 6.18 Release Candidate 7 dropped on November 23rd, and this is shaping up to be a pretty significant release for a few reasons. First off, this is expected to be the last major kernel release of 2025, and it's anticipated to become the annual long-term support kernel, which means if you're running enterprise systems or want something stable for the long haul, this is the one you'll want to keep an eye on. Now, RC7 is smaller than RC6, which is a good sign. Linus Torvalds himself said in the announcement that they're in good shape. RC6 had a last-minute VM regression that caused some issues, but it was a relatively trivial fix. Nothing to worry about too much. The stable release is expected on November 30th, so just a few days away at the time of recording. Unless something unexpected pops up and we get an RC8, but what's actually in this release? Well, RC7 brought some interesting hardware improvements. They fixed the MIPS RISC-V vendor ID, which was apparently incorrect in both the kernel and the QEMU testing code that developers were using. Bit embarrassing, but hey, it happens. More exciting for gamers, they've enabled both touchscreens on the Ionio Flip DS handheld gaming device. And there are improvements for the ASUS ROG Ally, Lenovo Legion Go, and various Alienware laptops. So if you're running Linux on any of these gaming handhelds, you're in for a treat. There's also support for the Elecom MXT3 URBK trackball and the Sonics AK870 Pro keyboard. So hardware support continues to expand, which is always great to see. Moving on to distributions. We had a couple of major releases this week. Oh, the big one is AlmaLinux OS 10.1, codenamed Heliotrope Lion. This dropped on November 24th, and it's a pretty substantial update. The headline feature here is Btrfs support. This has been available in AlmaLinux OS Kitten since early September, but it's now in the main release. You can install AlmaLinux on a Btrfs file system right from the beginning, which is great if you're a fan of Btrfs and its features like snapshots, compression, and all that good stuff. Beyond Btrfs, there's extended hardware support with new drivers. They've added a secondary version for x86-64 V2 processors, re-enabled SPICE support, and frame pointers are now enabled by default. They've also continued their work on KVM enablement for IBM Power in the virtualization stack. Security-wise, you're getting updated SELytix policies, OpenSSL with post-quantum cryptography support, which is pretty forward-thinking, and newer versions of SSSD and Keylime. Container folks will appreciate the latest versions of Podman and Builda, and new compiler toolsets and updated module streams for developers. It's available for all the usual architectures: x86-64, ARM64, IBM PowerPC, IBM Z. And there are container images, cloud images for AWS, Azure, Google Cloud, Vagrant boxes, Raspberry Pi images, even Windows subsystem for Linux. So pretty comprehensive coverage. We also saw AlmaLinux OS 9.7 released earlier in the week, which is their free alternative to Red Hat Enterprise Linux 9.7, bringing performance enhancements, updated development tools, and strengthened security. Other distributions that saw releases this week include KEE Neon 2025-1120, Proxmox 9.1 Virtual Environment, SNAL Linux 1.39, and Phoenix 251, which is a Linux distro for sysadmins that now has official OCI container images. All right, let's talk about desktop environments and applications, because there were some really cool releases this week. Blender 5.0 launched on November 18th, and this is a major release. The most significant change for many people is going to be full support for ACES pipelines, improved color management, and HDR capabilities. If you're doing any professional 3D work or color critical projects, this is a game changer. There are new volumes and SDF nodes and geometry nodes, which open up a lot of possibilities for procedural modeling. Storytellers get a new storyboarding template, and there are new array and scatter on surface modifiers for modeling. They've reworked UV sync, made a ton of animation and rigging improvements, and fixed 588 bugs. That's a lot of bugs. So this is a really polished release. GIMP 3.2 release candidate is now available for public testing. This has been a long time coming, and it's exciting to see it getting closer to final release. The RC includes more new features and improvements, and if you're a GIMP user, now's the time to test it and report any bugs you find. And KDE Plasma 6.5.3 was released on November 18th as well. This is the third maintenance update to the Plasma 6.5 series. The main improvement here is smoother visuals in multi-monitor VRR setups. So if you're running multiple monitors with variable refresh rate, this update should make things feel a lot smoother. There's also Budgie 1010, which is now Wayland only. This is a developer preview, so it's not quite ready for production use, but it's interesting to see Budgie making the jump to Wayland. Let's talk about hardware and drivers. VKD3D Proton 3.0 was released. This is the DirectX to Vulkan translation layer, and version 3.0 brings FSR4 support and a complete rewrite of the DXBC shader backend. If you're gaming on Linux, especially with AMD hardware, this will improve performance and compatibility. HP Linux Imaging and Printing, or HPLIP, version 3.258 was released, adding support for new printers. So if you've got a newer HP printer, you might want to grab this update. OpenVPN 2.6.16 arrived with a security fix and various bug fixes. Network Manager 1.54.2 adds support for configuring the HSR protocol version, and OpenSUSE released the Agama 18 installer with a cleaner, more intuitive storage UI. There were also a bunch of other releases. Git 2.52 with a new command for grabbing repository characteristics. Wireshark 4.6.1, PHP 8.5 with a pipe operator, URI extension, and clone with functionality. Calibre 8.15, the list goes on. Now, here's where things get really interesting, because we need to talk about what Linus Torvalds said about AI and coding. At the Linux Foundation Open Source Summit in Seoul, South Korea, earlier this month, Linus was interviewed by Dirk Hondel from Verizon, and they discussed AI in software development. Linus described himself as fairly positive about what's being called vibe coding, but with a big caveat. He thinks it's excellent as a way into computing, especially for people who might not otherwise be able to get computers to do what they want. But he's very clear that it's not for production coding, because from a maintenance standpoint, it would be, quote, horrible. He compared AI to other tools like compilers, saying that compilers freed people from writing assembly code by hand and increased productivity enormously, but didn't make programmers go away. He sees AI as just another tool in that same vein. What's interesting is that he's looking forward to a time when AI is less hyped and more like everyday reality that nobody talks constantly about, which, honestly, is the same. He also mentioned that AI crawlers have been very disruptive to a lot of our infrastructure at kernel.org, and that they do get bugs and security notices that are made up by people who misuse AI. But it's not as big a problem as it is for other projects like curl. On the topic of Rust in the kernel, he said Rust is actually becoming a real part of the kernel instead of being this experimental thing, though it's taken longer than expected. His role has changed from saying no to new ideas to sometimes saying yes against opposition from long-standing maintainers who kind of get stuck in a rut. Wow, and here's something that might surprise you. He said one of the nice parts of AI is that it made NVIDIA a good player in the Linux kernel space, which was famously not true 20 years ago. Remember when Linus gave NVIDIA the middle finger? Yeah, times have changed. There was also a significant announcement from the Linux Foundation. they launched the Open Robust Compartmentalization Alliance, or ORCA, on November 24th. This is a new foundation focused on improving software resilience by breaking software into secure, isolated parts to stop attackers in their tracks. The idea is that as automated and AI-driven attacks continue to expand, software security can't rely solely on patching vulnerabilities after the fact. ORCA introduces a forward-looking model that breaks software into isolated, resilient parts designed to contain threats before they spread. It's a coalition of leading universities, technology companies, and research institutions, spanning dozens of organizations from academia, industry, and government. If you're interested in software security and compartmentalization, definitely check out orca-lf.org. All right, so that's the Linux news for this week. We covered Linux kernel 6.18 RC7 and its expected stable release on November 30th. Alma Linux 10.1 with Btrfs support. Blender 5.0, GIMP 3.2 RC, and KDE Plasma 6.5.3. VKD 3D Proton 3.0, and other hardware updates. And Linus Torvalds' thoughts on AI and vibe coding. It's been a pretty packed week, and there's a lot to be excited about, especially with the kernel release coming up and all these application updates. If you found this video helpful, give it a thumbs up. Subscribe if you haven't already. And let me know in the comments what you think about Linus's take on AI coding. Do you agree? Are you using AI tools in your workflow? I'd love to hear your thoughts. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one. Peace!